is also maybe talked about that we all seem to know reasonably well about. Older than NHSI, right? So this is 1840, because it should be 1840. Anybody can recognize that? That's the methoxylon by following methoxylon. And this was done when at the time that the Portuguese conquered Sri Lanka, which was in 1656. So why do I have problem about all this? Just to highlight that many Chinese has been known way before any of these things happened. More than 100 years ago, people have been talking about many Chinese and have been describing the information, the cutoffs, all over the cutoffs in many ways. So this is a disease that we have been knowing, we have been treating for a long, long time now. And very well, very often about this disease that we have been, that has been with us all the time, that we have been treating for a long time is because of several reasons. One is that the incidence is actually quite high. It's 1.7 million people suffering from meningitis in the world in a year. And pediatric, the topic of pediatric meningitis is more important because 50% of them suffer in children, whereas childhood, like ranges from even if you take 0 to 16, childhood ranges way below 50% of our lifespan, whereas 50% of the meningitis comes from children. The mortal trait, although infection says 50-70%, there are also reports saying that it will approach 100%. If you are talking about contagious meningitis. And a mortal trait of 10%. So if you think of the most, like the diseases that you are scared of, when the diseases come to the world, what are the diseases that we worry about when we see? At least the parents worry about dengue. So what is the mortality in dengue? Nothing like this. I think dengue and the death and mortality probably we won't be able to complete lectures on the in the world looking after all our patients or something like that. So this is a disease that has been discussed that we are used to, so that we don't worry so much about the mortality factors. This is because we have seen this happening repeatedly. And the morbidity is also quite high, 22, maybe even sometimes up to 30%. Giving us a cumulative bad outcome. This one third of the patients that we are dealing with. At end, it is in the list of the top 10 causes of deadly children in the world, all over the world. And at one of the large chunks of the disability aspect. So let's look at Sri Lanka. You can see that is the Sri Lanka now at 34. We are doing very well. So top 10 causes in the world, and we are 34 when it comes to the causes of all of them. Let me ask you a question. Is meningitis a very common disease in Sri Lanka? Anybody who says yes? Go not wait for CT before they started and departed. A difference. Further analysis of the same study showed that there was actually a marked increase in the death, that is actually probability of death and time of hours to treatment. So I'm repeatedly harping on this. I think this is something that we find sometimes difficult to address because of various protocols, and our patients commonly come to us delayed, I think, and they get treatment from somewhere else and come to us delayed. So that's something that we can address to improve the outcome, which increases by 12.6% every hour that you delay your antibiotic treatment. Okay, from here, from this data and many other studies, we have come to this recommendation that in most of the guidelines, 30 to 60 minutes is the low to antibiotic time that you are supposed to achieve. That's nothing and nice, and that American Academy even says something even sooner than is better, obviously. Saying words, using words like urgent as soon as possible, right? As early as possible, should not be delayed. Okay, let's leave that topic and look at what some other things that causes delay in treatment. Of course, difficulty in clinical suspicion, as we all know, this is very common. Sometimes it's very difficult to find, get specific clinical signs or symptoms in a child especially the small children, it meningitis. So if you look at that, that's again the meningitis study done on patients with Haemophilus influenza. So out of the patients who were suspected to have meningitis, who were not to have meningitis, and that the Haemophilus meningitis and other meningitis, it's compared with this study. And if you can see, these non-specific features are quite similar in most of the patients. In the patients who subsequently had meningitis and did not have meningitis. So this is the difficulty. So what the guidelines are, this is the difficulty, that there is no one or two or three clinical signs that you can take together and say this child is having meningitis. And you are going to have to start treatment often empirically, if possible, whenever possible, after the lumbar puncture, or if not empirically, and then later sort out whether this child is having meningitis or not. And that is the recommendation in most of the guidelines that are out there as well. So just one more thing that we'll talk about when you're talking about diagnosis of meningitis, how we can improve the early diagnosis. CSF, smears, cultures remain the gold standard. Do not forget that they remain the gold standard, and you should attempt to do a lumbar puncture whenever possible in a child before starting antibiotics. Mandatory blood culture. Even if you cannot investigate, go for the CSF, we can always do a blood culture. But use of antigens, people have shown that use of antigens, which can be positive even up to 96 hours after treatment, can be quite useful for you to identify your pathogen, although that's not going to give you a GST. And also CSF lactate and serum prolactinone. This is in the serum, prolactinone and lactate in the CSF. Both are shown quite high sensitivity as well as a specificity for diagnosis of meningitis, and maybe we should be thinking about this. That will make life easy for us if we can do that. Okay, so moving from there, knowing that we have to give our antibiotics quickly, so we'll have a very brief look at, if we have to improve the outcome, what are the antibiotics that we have to give. Actually, I'm not going to talk about this because all these guidelines are there freely available on the internet. Just very briefly, I'll mention just our own microbiology guidelines, just for you to look at that. So just to highlight what we have been talking about, blood cultures should be collected before starting empirical antibiotics. That's how the guidelines start. CSF culture should be collected whenever possible prior to starting any possible antibiotics. So it says whenever possible, it's not mandatory. However, antibiotic therapy should not be delayed if the collection of samples is delayed. I don't think you want me to go through this. Do you want me to go through this? You all know very well about this, what antibiotics do. And what age group, depending on what you find. Right? I would just highlight this one or two things, that if you have an immunosuppressed patient or a basic patient or a patient with bacillocal fracture, or the patient has had any procedures or any implants that can into the CNS, vancomycin becomes a necessary medication. And also to highlight that in the setting of an infected implant, removal of infected shunt with appropriate antimicrobial therapy is the most effective treatment, and can be the only effective treatment in children who have infected. So that's another important thing that we need to remember if we are to improve the outcome in this subgroup of patients. Okay, so now we have treated our patient as early as possible, thinking of improving the outcome with the appropriate antibiotic, knowing the patient's situation. But what happens after that? So most of the studies that we looked at, if you remember, they had a low antibiotic time of 2 hours. And they had, when you go through the studies, they had actually high yields of their cultures and gave appropriate treatment. But still they ended up with a very high mortality. Knowing this, the medical practitioners have looked into the pathophysiology of the problems, the death and the disability in meningitis. And this is, I think, a very commonly well-known diagram, which depicts the activity of the bacteria, right? The bacterial components, all of which are named here, bacterial components, which evokes the host response, which gives rise to this edema, first ICP, neuronal damage, and then cascade. At the same time, bacterial toxins themselves can also do them. So there is inflammation as well as toxins that result in this death or mortality and the morbidity. Looking at that, so people have been thinking, yes, we have been treating with antibiotics, yes, we need to do something better than that. Not just the antibiotics. And they have thought about other adjuvant and supportive therapy. Lots of things have been tried, but I'm just going to go through probably one or two things that we all very well know about, just to show you the evidence that the evidence is actually there. So the common use things are steroids with aim of reducing inflammation, volume expansion to improve cerebral perfusion, and hyperosmolar therapy to reduce cerebral edema. And I think I'm probably happy to say that I think probably this is common practice in pediatrics right now, and most of the patients would be getting these things done for them. Okay, so just going to the Cochrane review, which is probably the sort of the best evidence base that we have on steroids. 4,000 participants, half of them children, right? 9 studies considered, no significant reduction in mortality with steroids, no significant reduction in mortality in adults. Right? We did not reach more significance in these things, but there were, in both these parameters, there were trends to improvement. But when it comes to pediatrics, there was actually a mild significant reduction in mortality, especially for the situation. But they did find that there were lower rates of severe hearing loss, any hearing loss, as well as neurological sequelae in children who steroids were used. And when you come to subgroup analysis, there was a reduced mortality in strep pneumonia meningitis, but not in hemophilus influenza or Neisseria meningitis meningitis, and which we wouldn't be knowing which organism we are dealing with at the time that we used the steroids. There was a reduction in severe hearing loss in children with hemophilus influenza, but not in adults and not in other meningitis. They also found that there was a difference between high income and low income countries. Yeah, the low-income countries did not seem to be needing the steroids. They could not explain this effect, but thought this was due to delayed presentation, presence of anemia and malnutrition. So, where do this other country fall to when we are considering high-income, low-income? We are in between. So, we are now a middle-income country, as we all know. And although malnutrition is there, the other factors that we see in the low-income countries are not so common at all in Sri Lanka, and we probably should be considering ourselves a high income country when it comes to treatment of meningitis. Right? So, going from there, so they, in case of the evidence, although the evidence was not very robust, as there was some advantage and no associated adversity. So, that's the important thing that we have to remember. None of these studies demonstrated any significant adverse effect, other than maybe prolongation of fever by using steroids. So the recommendation lies that use of dexamethasone before antibiotics in any all the protocols. That's another problem that we are sometimes faced with. The patients come to us without the steroids, and the current recommendations lie that, as I think all of you know, that the steroids are recommended to be given either with or just before, 10 to 20 minutes before, within that period of giving the antibiotics. And if our patient has come to us without antibiotics, we can still administer the first dose within 4 hours of starting antibiotics, maybe up to 12 hours, but there is no data to show the benefit once 12 hour gap has passed in children with pyogenic meningitis. Okay, so we are going to the second factor we were talking about. Now we have tried to tackle inflammation with giving dexamethasone, and now we are trying to increase the cerebral perfusion, support the cerebral perfusion, which has been shown to be one of the factors contributing to mortality, not only in meningitis, it's actually been better shown in other causes where patients go into non-traumatic as well as traumatic coma. Right? So this is just the meta-analysis. The Cochrane review considered 420 children. They compared maintenance fluid versus restrictive fluid. And if, I think probably, I don't know whether you all know, but at the time that I was a registrar, I think most of you all are registrar, we used to give 60% of the requirement to patients who came to us with meningitis because of fear of cerebrovidia. So they compared this and they found that improvement in the rate of, there was actually, they could not find an improvement in the mortality, but they found there was an improvement in the rate of spasticity and seizures, and later overall neurological symptoms as well. So therefore, the recommendation lies that we should use fluid resuscitation guided by the physical condition to maximize the brain perfusion without contributing to the edema, and that there is no place for fluid restriction in patients with meningitis other than in very specialized circumstances. Okay, so again the same thing. Patients should be kept euvolumic, not very strong buildup, but that's all that we have. Fluid restriction in attempt to reduce cerebral edema is not recommended. It does not seem to work. One. And whenever intravenous fluid therapy is required, the lowest tonicity you are supposed to go for is isotonic, say isotonic, not hypotonic, and that again I think is very common knowledge and very common practice now. So lack of evidence of significant harm from not restricting fluid, and some evidence of harm resulting from fluid restriction is what we have, and that is why the guidelines say that we should be giving the fluid rather than withholding the fluids. Okay. So we have talked about steroids, we have talked about volume, so how about hyperosmolar therapy? Again, something that all of us are practicing and all of us are very conversant about. Let's look at the evidence. Again, when it comes to Cochrane view, the evidence doesn't seem to be that robust, right? So they have only analyzed the use of glycerol as a hyperosmolar therapy, and actually glycerol is not any of you all using glycerol. So it's a very cheap agent that can even be given orally, can be given intravenously or orally, right? But we'll see why what are we using usually. We are using hypertonic saline. So we'll see why we are using hypertonic saline without glycerol. But if in a setting where you don't have hypertonic glycerol, they have hypertonic saline, they have found that glycerol is actually an effective agent. So small letters. So available osmotic therapies, that glycerol, mannitol, and hypertonic saline. And as we know, hypertonic glycerol is an osmotic diuretic, as opposed to hypertonic saline, which is an osmotic agent but not an osmotic diuretic. Both of these have, I will not go through this, but both of these have other mechanism. It's not just through the osmosis or osmotic diuresis that they cause improvement in circulation. And glycerol, they are probably not, people are not exactly sure, but they think probably it's osmosis that is helping here as well. And advantages being, lots of studies have been done. Glycerol cheap, can be oral. Mannitol, probably the advantage is that we are familiar with giving it a lot. Hypertonic saline, the major advantage being that it supports the circulation and there is no loss of volume that happens in mannitol, which even has been actually incriminated in giving rise to rebound cerebral edema. And just of note is that one adult trial with glycerol was suspended due to increase in mortality in people who were giving glycerol. So probably we should be sticking to the hypertonic saline like we do. So the same thing, right? Same thing, so I won't go through this one by one. Combinations and alone, glycerol, dexamethasone, glycerol and hypertonic saline. The rate ratio, the mortality, lowest here, highest here, right? So the mortality improvement was most noted with hypertonic saline, right? Let's not compare with other agents. Okay, so again, so hypertonic saline is effective, so I don't think we have to go through that because I have been talking about this for some time. But we are visited by lack of comprehensive recommendations. Like we do not have an exact guideline on how much sodium chloride we should be giving to which patient at what time and what are the exact targets that we can give. Yes, there are guidelines, but none of them are exactly evidence-based. So whatever we in evidence we have tells us that bolus dosing can be done without any issue at all, any problem, until the patient is having a sodium of 155. And if you go for infusion, this is in pediatric patients, and if you go for infusions, patients can tolerate even up to 170 millimoles per liter. Okay. So when you're looking at continuous hypertonic cement versus bolus hypertonic cement, which one should we be giving? So we do have data to tell us that higher levels of hypertonic, say salinity, is tolerated well if you are giving infusions rather than boluses. Right? At the same time, we do have some studies that examined this and came out with the answer that continuous hypertonic saline therapies were significantly greater, the improved functional outcome was significantly greater if we gave continuous hypertonic saline versus bolus hypertonic saline. And the same thing, so in the conclusion of, and these are two studies that if you all are interested, you can go and look up, two large and recent studies. And following the studies, they have looked at the other evidence as well and come to the same conclusion that perhaps that continuous infusion is better than bolus therapy in children with not just meningitis, in presbycic of ECOS. I probably skipped that one, that's the graph of the same thing. Okay, so we have come to the last part now. We have talked about what we can do to improve the, how we quickly we can make the diagnosis and what we can do to improve the outcome. When your patient is not improving, I think this is a very, very like a common thing that we see. When your patient is not improving, this is the time that we have problems. This one I'm not going to talk about. So this is common for all conditions. When your patient is not improving, having seizures or whatever, when your patient is not improving, this is what we do. We reassess the diagnosis and treatment. Are we dealing with a non-bacterial meningitis? Are we dealing with TB, fungal infection, some other atypical organism or something like that? Is it not meningitis? Is it like a chemical meningitis or something like that? Right? So we'll be thinking of so many other things when our patient is not improving, especially if we have not got cultures, positive cultures, which is quite common in our study. Right? So we'll be reassessing the diagnosis and we'll be reassessing the treatment to see whether we are giving sensitive antibiotics, proper doses, and the whole works. We will also be looking for complications, and we will also be looking at is the treatment reaching our target at adequate concentration, especially as we know that central nervous system penetration of antibiotics is famously impaired because of the blood-brain barrier. So I thought maybe I will very quickly, rather than trying to go through a list of complications, I thought very quickly we'll look at one or two patients to answer these questions. 6-month-old baby on treatment for pyogenic meningitis with Haemophilus influenza. We are lucky we have got the organism there. And an ABST as well, on sensitive antibiotic. So by day 8, general condition is improving, but fever is going on. And one day later you come to the ward. Baby is a little bit irritable and drowsy, and the fever is still going on. So what would you do? What would you think of and what would you do? Yeah? This is very common and something very, very all of us very well know about. So what would you be thinking of? That patient probably would have developed a, what would be, it's either a subdural effusion or maybe even an abscess. Right? So looking at this general condition improving, but fever is going on, and next day irritable and drowsy in a 6-month-old baby, probably with Haemophilus influenza, all those factors together would be making us think we are dealing with probably a subdural effusion. Correct the organism, correct age, everything is correct. Right? So this is what you would be liable to find. So whenever your patient has been treated with meningitis, and patient's fever is not responding, you would be thinking of subdural collections as well as abscess formation, which is going to necessitate an imaging. So the keyword here is that when your patient is not improving, and fever is going on and patient is becoming sick, you are probably going to have to go and repeat your imaging. Right? How about the management? What would you do in a subdural effusion? I think probably these things all of us know. Right? So if your fever is on, if you have signs and symptoms to say that the patient is having any raised pressure due to this correction, or if the patient's fever is not settling, then we will be going and evacuating the subdural. And it might even be useful in instances where we don't have an organism, because we might actually get some chance of getting at an organism if we do the intervention. And this is just to highlight that the age groups, right? Age groups where the subdural correction were commonest was from 0 to. So this is the non-subdural. These are people who had subdurals with the same sort of clinical presentation. This is common in the less than 1 year age group, especially in the population that we see. Might be even be seen in older people, but that population we will not be seeing. Okay, so second patient. This one's 5 years old, older baby. Diagnosis is strep pneumonia, as you would be expecting, and that becomes more common now. Here, again, we have organism, we have antibiotics on, sensitive antibiotics. So patient now, we have been treating for 10 days. Atypical condition improved, right? So we are all happy. Patient's fever has settled, we have an organism, we have given antibiotics, patient's better, no fever. Then suddenly what happened? So developed 3 seizures, right? So 3 seizures on that day. Now we all get excited and we think, although there is no fever, have we not completely treated the antibiotic? Completely sterilized the CSF? Are we still treating the same patient? Right? So the common things when we do when our patients are not improving is repeating the CSF and repeating imaging. And again, I think probably, like, it's very much less now, but I can remember at the time that I started practicing, there was a great reluctance to repeat imaging and to repeat CSF examination, but I think probably we are all doing it now quite commonly. If you are not happy with where the child is, things are going. These things are not recommended as routine, but if they are not happy where the child is going, this is what you should be doing. So both done. CSF normal, CT normal. What would you do now? Your child is very fit. You obviously were anxious at it. What would be the possibilities then? So we have gone and done an MRI. Right? So we have gone and done an MRI, because in atypical children following meningitis who are developing complications, especially in the second week of treatment with aseptic CSF, the commonest thing you see is that there are infarctions or evidence of vasculitis. This will not be seen on your CT scan. And this is a diffusion restriction imaging, you are seeing restriction in the diffusion. So what could you do? Again, the management recommendations are not very clear. There are different schools of thought, right? But generally, the management, so if your CSF is sterile, would be biased towards giving anti-inflammatory medications, namely steroids. Right? Again, the recommendations are not very robust. So another clinical scenario, same patient. I did not put that picture up. You might be seeing when you do your MRI, which was negative in the CT, you might be seeing actually venous sinus thrombosis with a venous infarction rather than an artery infarction. What would you do at that instance? So venous sinus thrombosis with venous infarction, what's the common management? What would you be generally doing if the child is like if in any child? Depending on the venous sinus that is involved, if it is knocked off, what you call the sinus that's used? I'm getting divisive. You know the sinus I'm talking about. If it's not that, right, then you will be anticoagulating your patient, right? But when it comes to a setting of infection, right, meningitis complicated, venous sinus thrombosis complicated by meningitis, against the evidence is not robust, and especially if an active infection is going on, you have to be wary about doing anticoagulation, because the blood vessels are very fragile at this time, and you might end up with a massive impact. So that's sort of about sort of where the evidence stands. Nobody gives a very firm recommendation, but you have to consider in each individual case, and unless your venous sinus thrombosis is progressing, you might be failed before anticoagulation and just treat with the antibiotics. Okay, so a different patient. So 5-year-old baby, same baby, threatening pneumonia, unsensitive antibiotics, so probably the same baby. But this one transferred you from a peripheral hospital, and they have isolated the organism, they have been treating, they have been doing well. So by day 10, patient is afebrile. So they have been happy, again like we have been happy with the previous patient. Patient is afebrile. But they have found that the deteriorating. And you are seeing a bradycardia and a hypertension with dystonic posture. So what are you going to be thinking about here now? This afebrile patient, So I think I'm hearing a lot of people saying that, so you are thinking of again the complication that is associated with raised intracranial pressure, which is namely, what would you be thinking of? So this is the patient's CT scan, what are you seeing there? So you are seeing a dilatation of the ventricles, so we will be thinking this is the entity that is most dangerous, one of the most dangerous complications of meningitis. And it is usually not even a late presentation, it can happen even in the very acute stage. So when your patient is monitored, if your patient has come to your ward, you have already done an investigation, you have already done a CT on the patient, you have done your LP after the CT was completely normal, patient starts like several hours or 24 hours later, patient starts exhibiting the same signs and symptoms. So do not hesitate to repeat your imaging, because he might in between have developed this condition. And I must say that sometimes this hydrocephalus or enlarged ventricles will be very mild and very difficult to recognize in your very first CT unless you have a background CT of your patient. And you might end up calling those ventricles even normal. But so this is the CT done at the peripheral hospital. Commonly if you do the CT 24 to 48 hours later, this is what you will be seeing. And now you know what your management should be, but the mainstay now is not going to be antibiotics, it's going to be surgery. So the patient is going to need shunting or EVD depending on the patient's protein level, and might even need bilateral interventions if there is a very high CSF protein which is going to cause a block in the communication between the ventricles. Okay, I think that's the last question. So 5-year-old baby, again the same age. Pyogenic meningitis, but this time it's Pseudomonas, not strep pneumonia. Different scenario, Pseudomonas known to be more difficult to treat, more multi-drug resistant, so they have got an ADSP, but we are treating. We have changed antibiotic, but EVA is not settling, and they are also, again, this patient is transferred from a peripheral hospital. Deteriorating GCS, but we don't have firm signs of raised ICP. So what would you be thinking of in this particular patient? So don't take this peripheral hospital as an insult, infant, or something like that. Why is this probably a common practice? Because these patients improve. Patients improve and then they deteriorate, and we do not want people in any hospitals to transfer all the patients with meningitis within the first 24 to 48 hours or whatever, to the very big hospitals or something like that. So here we have a more different clinical scenario. Here we have an organism which we are trying to treat, but we have an ABSD also. It is sensitive to only few drugs. We are trying to treat, but we don't seem to be getting anywhere basically from word go. And this is common when you have multi-drug resistance and when you have, what's that condition that we are seeing? We have a ventriculitis. This is a contrast CT and this is a contrast CT. Here you are seeing the enhancement along the ventricle wall. So by the time you have a ventriculitis and you have a resistant organism, then you have problems. So what can we do here? Yes, we have given proper doses of antibiotics. This patient is probably going to need an extravasational, like some sort of a shunt procedure as well. So he's going to need a shunt procedure. may not be looking at the initial information, we are probably not going to be able to put in a shunt, and we are probably going to have to go for EVD. So anything else that we can do to improve the outcome of this patient at this point? Yeah, I can hear some people saying that. So then we might be thinking of intraventricular or intrathecal antibiotics, right? So there is a whole host of studies commonly used in ventriculitis, complicating some of these has been post neurosurgical, others have been without a neurosurgical procedure, commonly used in multi-drug resistant organisms who are resistant to many antibiotics, and only sensitive to antibiotics that cross the blood-brain barrier very poorly. And it would make sense that then you need to go and deliver your antibiotics directly into the ventricular system. So again, I do not propose to go through all that, but they have found shorter lengths of hospital stay, lower mortality, especially among severely ill patients, and not seen many adult toxic side effects. Improved outcome, especially in multi-drug resistant infections, in which patients we have the most difficulty treating. In patients who are not responsive to standard therapy, with little side effects, reducing the relapse rate, very quick CSF sterilization, effective and safe treatment for multi-drug resistant organisms, and improved survival. So all these are the things that we have been finding. So maybe any of you all have treated your patients with intrathecal antibiotics? The patients, anybody has any experience? Right. So probably we should be thinking about these things in our complication patients who die on us without improving. Okay, so I have come to the end. And just to summarize what we have been talking about, we have been talking about the high mortality and morbidity in spite of specific treatment in meningitis. And we have talked about the role of early antibiotics within 30 minutes to 1 hour to improve the outcome. High index of clinical suspicion, where you would be treating a child without avoiding delays for investigation. Use of steroid supporting circulation as well as hypertonic saline, which may be better given as an infusion. Right?